Hello there, party people. Welcome to the September 2019 Patreon collaboration. So before we get started, we want to start gathering some references. Whenever I think of mythological paintings, I always think of the old classical style paintings. So I wanted to create something that had a classical feeling to it. So I gathered some art that I found really encompassed the classical feeling that I was going for and started going to town. Here is some line work that I have prepared. We are taping it to the light table and going to transfer it over to some Arches 140-pound hot press paper. The main difference between hot press and cold press is that hot press has no tooth to it. Colors are more vibrant because it's sitting directly on the surface and it doesn't get soaked in. But it's also a lot more finicky and is a lot less forgiving. The paper I did the line work is also a lot larger than the paper I have to paint on, so I'm having to figure out how to fit everything in. We are going to be transferring the figure down into the appropriate area, but then kind of hodgepodging the loom with the tapestry in the background in to fit in behind her. Oh, Midna. Hey there. So why don't we talk about this myth, Arachne, one of my absolute favorites. There are several versions that I've heard through my life. Most of them start with the girl herself, Arachne, pridefully boasting about her skills with the loom. It generally ends with her challenging Athena, a goddess who was known to be a master of the loom as well, to a contest. In some versions, Zeus is made to judge who is the winner of the contest. In others, the women themselves are going to be the judges. In the version that I tend to think of most readily, Athena weaves a beautiful tapestry about the glory of the gods and all of the wonderful things that they've done. But Arachne weaves one that shows the depravity of the gods and how they tend to hurt humanity. And regardless of the contents of the tapestries, Arachne's is technically better. And this greatly upsets Athena, who turns her into a spider so that she is forced to weave forever. In another version, the rules of the contest are whoever loses is never allowed to weave again. And in this version, Athena wins. And Arachne is so distraught over this, she decides to kill herself. And Athena, pitying her, brings her back to life, but turns her into a spider so she's allowed to weave again, and is not technically breaking their oath because she's no longer who she was before. As we continue to fit the tapestry inside of the actual painting, I've decided to go with two different myths for Arachne's display, one of which being Apollo and Daphne, and the other being Leda and the Swan, which, if you don't know, the Swan is actually Zeus in disguise. Now that our line work has been transferred over to the painting paper, it's time to prepare the paper for painting. So we pull out the board that we intend to stretch the paper to, get out our brushes and our gum or framing tape. Measure out the tape that you'll be needing for the different sizes of the edges of the paper, and lubricate the gum side until it becomes tacky, and start taping it down. Once it's taped, get it washed down gently with your hockey brush, dab away excess moisture, and blow dry until completely dry and flat. And also warm your hands because it's freezing.
Midna! Welcome back, baby!
God, she's so cute. And now to put together our palette. Based on our reference photos, we are going with a very orange and blue color scheme. So, pulling out our sample cards, and some paint cups that seem to have related colors, we start going through and deciding which colors we would like. As we start sampling out our colors on a fresh little palette card, we can see where our values are laying. We want to make sure to have as full a range of value as possible, which is why we kind of redid the brown there underneath the dark orange. And now with an oval wash brush and some clean water, we want to saturate the surface that we want to color block our first layer on. And going with a nice subtle gold, we're going to start laying down color on the tapestry and then moving on to her body. The purpose here is to fully cover everywhere that's going to have a lot of layering down on it, giving us visual reminders of what's going where and just filling things in. Ugh, what a bomb-ass orange that is. Damn, look at that. It's gorgeous. You can see that the paint is no longer blooming, and that is because the surface has already started to dry up. You can typically prevent this by keeping a small spray bottle filled with clean water nearby and spritz the surface to keep it damp. But I keep forgetting to get one, and thus I've paid the price in sadness. Now that the paper is fully dry, we start working on smaller details that require harder lines, that we don't want to look as soft, that we want to look more solid, such as the frame of the loom. That kind of stuff is very important to keep in mind, especially if you're trying to have a variety of different textures within your painting. If you want something to look soft and rounded, it's nice to have the ability to gradient, but if you want something hard and solid and stiff looking, you want to try to keep your shading quite harsh. Not too harsh, but enough to differentiate and make it visually appealing. If everything is highlighted, then nothing's highlighted, you know what I mean? Now that our base layer is down, we start the process of constant layering called glazing. We'd begin with our medium tones in our palette, as watercolor works most naturally from light to dark. As we're going for a classical style painting, our reference figures seem to be very dramatically pale. So in order to achieve this, I want to start lifting pigment out a little bit earlier than we normally do, just to make sure that she remains as pallid as possible. And some areas of her arm are not quite as pale as we want them to be, so just starting to lift. And it helps us keep an eye on our shadows as well. Putting a wash over something that has had different tones of layering in will tend to blend the layering in and be a little more seamless together, which is what I'm doing here with the hair.
Mature content alert!
So I didn't check if orb weaver spiders are native to the areas the myths originated from, which is usually something I'm pretty fastidious in doing, but I decided to use them anyway for purely aesthetic reasons. And you know what? That's fine. The colors of their legs and the stripes, it's all just so beautiful and fits really well with the color scheme. Beyond that, I thought that the stripes on the legs would make for a very interesting design choice, as I wanted her to be shown mid-transformation. And if we did something that was just a flat color, it wouldn't be quite as obvious that her body was undergoing a metamorphosis. So I decided to try to mirror the different stripes in equivalent places on her still human limbs, which you will see later. While things are still somewhat light, I want to try to keep a handle on the high-lit areas to maintain our classical, very pallid look. So we are lifting out some tones from her face, trying to get a very, very accurate anatomical form in the way that the light is playing off of her various curves, and trying to keep the hair nice and fluffy. The moment of truth. Spider eyes! God, I love it. Oh, here come those stripy limbs. God, I'm so proud of this concept. You see, I'm trying to put them in equivalent places based on the various joints in the human limbs and the spider limbs. I think I more or less got it right. Now it's time to start working with our medium to dark tones. This time, going with blue to offset all of the various orange tones in her body. Again, something that seems to be quite prevalent in our classical references. And in areas where regular blue isn't enough, we go with our dark, dark spider blue color. It's to try to give everything a nice full range of value. Something nice and fully rendered. I generally try to not fully render everything in the painting because it can become quite overwhelming to look at. You won't really have anywhere comfortable to keep your eye line on. But a lot of these classical paintings were overwhelmingly rendered. And, well, I wanted to try it out. Thank you. Now that our dark tones have reached a satisfactory point, we begin to lay the foundations of her see-through spider silk robe by lifting away pigment from everywhere that we want it to sit. We fully rendered her body underneath with this in mind, knowing that not all of it would be seen, but the areas where the fabric is most bunched up would be pulled away just so that you get the hints of her nakedness underneath. Before going in for a final round of details using our Derwent Inktense ink blocks and our highlighting pen, we want to put on some soft but minimal details onto the mural in the background. Completely contradictory to what I had said earlier, I am refusing to overly render this in the background because I definitely want your focus to at least stay on Arachne herself. As we mix colors up for the different threads inside the tapestry, we want to make sure to keep at least a little bit behind so that we can add them to the loose, unused threads at the bottom of the loom. Here we go. Loose thread colors at the bottom of the loom. I see you there. Ink time! Yay! As usual, we scrape our pigments off of the block itself and strain it off into the wells inside the actual ink block's case place. And mix in a bit of water, trying to keep the consistency as dry as possible so that the inks paint on nice and opaquely. Once it's mixed to the consistency of our choosing, we want to pop it into some key places to get things highlight with our highlighting ink. You know what I mean. You know what's going on. Maybe a little more lifting. Yeah, why not? At this point, it's pretty much a pull and push game. You could probably sit forever doing this, adding more dark tones, pulling more out. This is the part where you have to really trust your gut and not listen to the constant nagging voices that tell you it's never going to be finished. Because it won't. Unless you let it be. Please don't do this to yourself. Just let it go. And now it's time for line work. I like to start with the outside lines, keeping them quite a bit thicker than the inner detail lines, I like to call them, which harkens back to the beautiful Art Nouveau era that I think is just perfect and I do it forever and you can't stop me. And that's gonna do it. Thank you guys so, so much for your patronage and for watching this video. I hope that you found it entertaining and informative. Remember that I'm always here to answer any questions that you guys may have. So if you have any, you can message me here on Patreon, you can message me on Discord, even pop on by one of my Twitch streams and just pop that question right into my face. I hope you look forward to the next video. I certainly look forward to making it, and I hope to see you again next time. Thank you again so much, and bye.